Sort of funny because we've had a few informal conversations and I don't know exactly your title and the things. I mean, I know that you're involved in politics and I know that you're a mayor, I think of one of the boroughs of Monterey. Is this correct?
Sí, del área metropolitana. Son 11 y Escobedo es uno de ellos.
Okay. How many people in your jurisdiction?
450,000.
Okay. Well, that's bigger than this area pretty much. So that's quite an undertaking you have.
Responsabilidad.
What made you decide to go into politics?
Tratar de cambiar la realidad de la comunidad. Tratar de ayudar a los que necesitan más. Y nací en eso. Mi familia es como la parte del que platicábamos en los días pasados de el área que yo creo importante atacar o atender. La fábrica de la violencia. En mi casa hubo fábrica de político. Mi papá era político. Mi abuelo era político. Y yo no quería ser, pero terminé la escuela y mi papá me dijo que había cumplido su responsabilidad de darme estudios y que no seguiría manteniéndome hasta que hiciera lo que él quisiera. Y yo no quise hacer lo que él quería. Y me puse a trabajar en varias partes hasta que llegué a este municipio. Fui a trabajar unas horas para sobrevivir y luego irme a trabajar a una empresa privada como ciudadana y me di cuenta que podía hacer mucho adentro. Desde una señora que esperaba mucho tiempo y que le ayudé a que no esperara tanto, hasta establecer su área jurídica, si tenían acta de nacimiento, la papelería en orden legal. Iba a salir a las 3 de la tarde y salía a las 12 de la noche. Y entonces, de ahí ya no me separé. Sábados y domingos y 24 horas.
What was your education before?
Leyes. Y luego hice una maestría en Derecho Público y en Gobierno Municipal.
Are you a lawyer also?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. Did you ever practice law?
Poquito. No me gustó.
Okay. It's interesting because in some ways, law and politics are interesting bedfellows, interesting partners.
Debieran ser. Mm-hmm. Para mínimo hacer lo correcto.
So why didn't you like law?
Porque había corrupción. No me gustó.
And you felt...
Y creo que puedo ayudar más. Hay dos áreas en el gobierno. La que hace leyes y la que procura bienestar. Y me gusta más esa.
Ah, okay. Well, as we've spoken, I know that you have a lot of deep thoughts about being involved in politics. Inherent in politics is the possibility of great good or great not so good.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a balance. And with a lot of politicians that I've met, they don't quite look at it that way. They see them as mixed together, but you don't, which I like. I think that's very good. What have your thoughts been in our conversations since we've been going back and forth between those two things? Because as a politician, you face a lot of temptation, and some of that temptation is hard to figure out if it's good or bad. And then other parts of that temptation are bad, but a lot of people do it. And then there's some parts of the temptation that are just completely bad that I think everyone agrees they don't want to be involved with. So what are your thoughts on what we've spoken about?
Que yo sabía que el estar en donde estoy merece una gran responsabilidad por la confianza que me otorga los ciudadanos. Pero hoy lo veo más, con mucha más responsabilidad. Porque además de no, lo que yo veía antes era no quería defraudar a los ciudadanos. Quería regresar a ser ciudadana y que no tuvieran rencor conmigo por haber hecho algo que no les hubiera gustado. Pero ahora voy a regresar a ascender ser ciudadana. Y eso va a ser una gran responsabilidad desde hoy. Si le pusiera números, sería... Yo sentía una responsabilidad de 70. Y hoy de 100. Porque sé que tengo que hacer un gran papel, pero además puedo demostrar que no todos los políticos somos iguales. Como los que conociste. ¿Cuál es el rol ideal que debe de jugar el ciudadano en una sociedad y el gobierno como herramienta?
It's an interesting thing because there's no such thing as a government. A government is a structure that's inhabited by people. How the government works, the strength of the government, really depends on the people that inhabit it, that populate it. So the level of civilization of a population directly affects how the government is utilized as a tool. So independent of what type of government it is, people have the ability to bolster that government up and make it something that's very noble, or not, and make it something very oppressive. So it really all rests on the nature of the population itself, how they experience what it means not only to be human, but in the case of Mexico, what it means to be Mexican, what it means to come from Monterrey, what it means to be in their specific community, and what it means to be in their family. All of these things are important. So by having things in society that build those things stronger, the government will follow. But government's always an effect of the citizens. And it's one effect of citizens. It's my belief that citizens should have a very active citizen role in civilization. It's unfortunate that a lot of people in government systems, that is people who are the governed, believe that somehow civilization will come from the government. And that ideally they could be totally passive in their lives. And things like justice and civilization and compassion will just effortlessly exist. So an education needs to occur. Ideally, it starts with simple practices within a family and simple practices and examples within a community. And just like there needs to be a family leader, there needs to be community leaders. And ideally, even regional leaders. But especially from the community, what I would say downward, microscopically, there needs to be a much greater focus than there is in many parts of the world.
¿Y no crees que está pasando, bueno, al menos en México eso está pasando, que con la tecnología, creo yo que es la tecnología o la globalización, los ciudadanos están perdiendo la formación anterior de en donde había un líder en una casa? Entonces, los hijos callan a los papás. Y su formación no es estructural con liderazgos. No es vertical. Es horizontal. Y eso está causando, siento yo, o pregunto, te pregunto si crees que eso causa un cambio rotundo en la estructura incluso del gobierno. Porque ya no va a ser vertical, va a ser horizontal. Y entonces el ciudadano empieza a tomar una actitud desde la familia que puede estar más cerca de la violencia, mucho más violenta o agresiva.
When you talk about horizontal, what do you mean? I may be having some problem translation-wise.
Okay. Horizontal es que no reconocen una figura de respeto en la familia. Con respeto me refiero al líder de la familia, que en México siempre había sido el papá. Y con los cambios de la sociedad, que un factor es la globalización y otro factor es la incursión de las mujeres en la vida laboral. Eso ha permitido, esos dos factores y algunos otros, han permitido que no haya respeto, a eso le llamo horizontal. Respeto del ciudadano hacia la figura del papá en la familia y tampoco del gobierno. Porque hay una falta de valor, o sea, de reconocimiento de valor del político y del ciudadano. ¿Tú crees que eso haga más violento a la sociedad?
What you're saying reminds me of a quote. I don't have the quote completely, but it's always fascinated me. The quote essentially says, the person who's saying the quote, he can't imagine how society will be able to be run, have any sort of order with the youth of today. That they're disrespectful of their elders. They speak when they're not supposed to speak. And he goes on and says several things about that. And this quote comes from something, I think the year it was said, is something like 500 BC. It's an age-old problem. And societies struggle in different ways. But I do think there's something that has happened in the planet that makes human history different. If we continue as we've continued for thousands of years, we won't end up in a place that's nearly as good. It won't nearly be as good as if we create a radical change in the way we bring up our children, in the way we view communities, and in the way we view nations. Way back when, the family unit had a head of it, the father, almost by necessity. If that weren't the case, there was so much work that was required to feed a family, and that if the father wasn't there, the family wouldn't have a good life. And communities really had to work to have their substance. If they were a farming community, they had to do a lot of farming just in order to sustain themselves. And even the same thing with nations, kingdoms and nations. But now with technology, humans have to work far less to be able to have better lives. So some degree of respect was required for survival in the past. Not so required now. This is both an opportunity and a problem. And not that opportunities and problems are oppositional, but a problem can lead into something that isn't good. We no longer, to survive, need to uphold this structure. We have the ability to look at our lives and decide how we want to dictate them without reacting to circumstances. You know, in the past, if I didn't go and work in the field for 12 hours, I wouldn't have food for my family. There really wasn't much choice. Now we have more choice. It's more difficult then, because 500 years before Christ was born, they really did have to respect their elders to some degree. Otherwise, they wouldn't be able to survive as families, communities, or nations.
Ahora sí.
Now it's different. So what needs to happen is people have to become more self-aware. And within our educational system, this has to be fostered so that people can not only see that they have an option, but take the more difficult option that leads to a better civilization. But what I mean by education is not just what's in the schools.
Sino lo que decías de que tienes que caer para aprender a caminar.
Yes. So, ideally, we can't take a group of people and make them the way we want them to be by putting a mold around them in the form of laws with enforcement. Ideally, what we do is we put little seeds of incentives, little practices that some people do that inspire others to do it, so that the society grows more in a direction that is towards civilization. Now, if you look at civilization, the more civilized and ethical a group of people are, the less enforcement is necessary. The more primitive a group is, the more enforcement is necessary to have them be civilized. So if you take a group of people and you tend to add things that cause more enforcement, you tend to steer in a direction that is further away from civilization.
Mm-hmm. ¿Y cuáles son esas cosas que tiene que hacer básicas la familia?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the next question is, you want to know how to go from the horizontal structure to more of a vertical structure. Mm-hmm. With respect to a vertical structure, what does it mean when you respect someone?
Cuando sabes lo que siente o lo que le cuesta o lo que ha vivido durante algún tiempo, para llegar a ser lo que es. No invadir sus vivencias para no agredirlo.
How does a 16-year-old, a person who's been on the earth for 16 years, understand what it means to go through 30 years of hardship?
Sí, no sabe. Sabiendo que cuestan las cosas, que cuestan en tiempo, en esfuerzo. Supongo que enseñándolos a reconocer el esfuerzo que se hace cuando tienen comida. Y como, y como hay gente, mis abuelos o mis bisabuelos no podían tener la comida tan fácil como ahora ellos lo tienen. Supongo. Pero esa no es tarea del gobierno. ¿O sí?
I've always been interested in how children learn effort strategies. And there are certain things that a little difference makes a big difference. For example, some children get allowances. And the children think of those allowances as money that comes to them because they're the kid and they live. If they look at the money in exchange for chores that they do, and there's a standard number of chores that they need to do for their money, and if they do those chores well and do more of them, they can earn more, then the allowance becomes a different thing. I find children that are paid allowances just because they're children grow up to feel very entitled, often, and want an allowance from the world. Children that learn the earning principle early on, even on a small level, where the household chores that they do should be done well, or they have to be done again, and the child can be even more helpful and gets more for themselves by earning more and being more helpful within the family, have a whole different view of the same thing, money that they get every week. So that's part of the answer to your question, but you had other questions. I don't want to keep on talking, and I know it's harder with translation.
Okay. Sí. Entonces, hay que educar bien a los hijos para tener una sociedad más violenta.
I think it's important to understand what violence is. Violence is not the act, I believe. I believe violence is the intent. And as we had another discussion, I asked you a difficult question. If your little boy, who is 4 years old, you had said, had a high fever and was hallucinating and was running away from demons and running towards a cliff, and he's going to run off the cliff, would you shoot him with a gun in the knee to save his life? Sounds like an absurd question, but is shooting him in the knee like that a type of criminal violence? If your child is about to get run over by a car, would you push him out of the way? Is that push an act of violence? If you're nonviolent, do you just allow the child to get hit by the car? The intent of people, if that intent comes from fear and ultimately hate, those acts are violent. If you're acting towards someone as if they were a beloved child of yours, often those same acts are not violent. So understanding the basis, violence is a tool. If you're going to go outside and chop wood with an axe, And you very gently take the axe, tap the wood, because you don't want to be violent. It's going to be a long time before you cut that wood. If you take all of your force and even maybe get your adrenaline going and hit that wood as hard as you can, you get the job done. Violence is a tool. It's not violence in the same way if the intent of it is love.
¿Y cuál es el propósito entonces de el gobierno como herramienta?
That's, you know, an interesting question. What is the purpose of government? If there are a group of people that have a common interest, that common interest can be understood and aided, furthered by a leader. You might say that that leader is a type of government official. To govern something is to control it. But government doesn't mean govern everything. If there ever came a day where the government determined what we wore, when we woke up in the morning, what we ate, and what we said, we would have a problem, I believe. So the question of government is what's being governed. Is it the actions of people? Well, if they're civilized people, there's not so much that the government has to worry about. If you have a family that's basically civilized, and not all families are, the government really doesn't have much place in that family.
¿Qué porcentaje de las familias crees que están civilizadas?
It depends what level of civilization.
Bueno, poquito.
Well, before determining if the family is civilized, you have to determine if the people are civilized. As governments are created by people and inhabited by people, mm-hmm. so are families. Smaller unit. Mm-hmm. So you ask what percentage of people are a little bit civilized. If I were to give a very broad definition of civilization, I don't think most animals are civilized. I don't think cats are very civilized. I don't think lions are very civilized.
¿Nosotros?
Well, I'm getting there. Maybe dolphins have a little bit of civilization. Okay. I don't know. I haven't studied dolphins so much, but I've heard rumors. Civilization seems to be the ability and actualization of an individual to look at the betterment of others beyond the betterment of their in-the-moment impulses. Mm. The question is, do you know of any cat that wakes up in the morning and thinks, I wonder what I could do today for the betterment of all cats? That doesn't happen. Happens with some humans, though. So the nature of civilization is the ability to have an ideological existence outside of our primitive impulses, outside of the basic desires of the body, to eat, to sleep, to have pleasure, to have comfort. As much as we can go against those things to uphold an abstract notion is our degree of civilization. We call that character. Now, character has to be tempered with morality, but that brings civilization. Does that answer your question?
Sí. Me dio una perspectiva más real de qué tanta. personas estamos civilizadas, pero la que no me has respuesto es cuál es el propósito del gobierno.
I know, we're getting there. That was in the first section.
Okay.
Hey, I will say there's something called the marshmallow test, which is a test of character to some degree in little children. The marshmallow test, you have a little child, and they have a marshmallow in front of them. And they're told that if they don't eat the marshmallow and they wait, they'll get a second marshmallow. And there are many children that can't wait, but there are some that do. And the studies seem to indicate that those children that can wait do better things in life. Ultimately, if I were to think of what a government is to do, the type of government is best suited for the type of people that inhabit the government. If you have a group of primitives and you give them a very ideological form of government with no enforcement, it won't work. Primitives need to understand things of the body, things of the emotion. They need to have things taken away. That doesn't mean it has to be with violence. There are other ways of taking things away other than what you might call violence. Things intended by fear. So in order to figure out the exact function of a government, you need to understand where people are right now. And to some degree conform how the government operates amongst those people to how those people are, with the hopes of bringing them to a different level. I believe the function of government is to inspire order, but not necessarily to create it. Government is good when a group of people want a representative of certain ideas, ideologies, to interrelate with other governments. So for example, Mexico has its own currency, has its own set of cultures, has certain needs of the Mexican people with respect to culture, geography, and ideology. And there are no individuals that can meet the needs of the whole country without some organizing principle. So if Mexico wants to interrelate with the United States, whether it's people like President Obama or someone who's running for president like Donald Trump, two very different people, two very different attitudes towards Mexico, Mexico needs people to interact with them. And people that represent the interests of everyone in Mexico. And this is a wonderful simplification. If I'm the president of the United States, and I need to interrelate with Mexico, I need someone who understands Mexico far better than I ever will. I can't possibly understand all of the countries I need to interrelate with to the depth as someone from that country, especially an elected official that is given, if you will, the I consider it a sacred honor of carrying the interests of not only all of the people, but the nature and history of that country, and upholding that, interrelating with the other groups of people of the world, other nations.
Pero, esa es una función del mm-hmm. gobierno. Pero si aplicamos el principio de que es un de que en México pudiera haber una sociedad primitiva y una sociedad más civilizada, los objetivos de esos dos gobiernos serían diferentes. Porque uno tendría que ver con lo del elevar el nivel de la sociedad primitiva y bajo unas herramientas, unos programas, y el otro haría lo mismo, pero con otros programas, porque la sociedad es diferente.
It depends if the society wants to be elevated.
¿Y si no? ¿Y el gobierno sí quiere? O sea, si el gobierno sí tiene personas que quieren elevar ese nivel y la sociedad no.
Then it sounds like those people are not doing well by the people they represent. That's a type of dictatorship.
El que usa la violencia. Bueno, no, la represión.
If I represent a group of people that I'm a vegetarian, and let's suppose I represent a group of people that all want to eat meat, but I decide because of my position of power, I'm going to elevate them, and understand that's my opinion of what an elevation is, take meat away from all of their tables, make them all vegetarians. Such an elevated society it would be. I'm saying that sarcastically. It's not my right to do so.
¿Cuál es tu derecho? En ese supuesto.
If I decide to take on the sacred mantle of representing meat eaters, I have to represent them as they would want to be represented. Now, whether it is how you define what their wants are depends on the system of government. A lot of people have changed the meaning of the word democracy. A lot of people think democracy has to do with freedom and a number of things like that. A more narrow definition of democracy is majority wins, which isn't very good for minorities. And the most popular idea is the one that stays. And other ideas that are more minor may never see the light of day to even try to become the majority idea. As a matter of fact, depending on how I execute that narrow definition of democracy, it could make sure that a society never moves. Because every minority idea or culture can be eliminated. Or if we don't eliminate it by force, strip it of rights and viability.
Entonces, cuando hay gobiernos que toman medidas populistas, aunque no sean las mejores económicamente para el país o para el gobierno que representan, pero son lo que la gente quiere, están en lo correcto.
Well, the first question and the thing I'm working towards is how to define what the people want. Is it what most people want? The narrow definition of democracy, majority rules? Is it the nature of what the most educated people want? In other words, some people care and study what's needed. Other people take someone who's maybe in a coma or in not mentally very able. Mm-hmm. Do they have the same wisdom in view as the person that studies all of these things? The United States attempted to resolve some of these issues by using what's called a form of government, the republic, a republic. In each area, we have people that represent the interests of the people. Ideally, they're elected as an expert. someone who is able and someone who cares to see what would be best for their area. And there's a cooperation between that person and the people that they represent. That cooperation starts with their election. The people, the majority of people, agree this is a good person to study us, to represent us, maybe even to understand us better than we understand ourselves. Maybe some of us live around a lake. Maybe some of us live by a river. Maybe some of us live by a desert. The economic principles of the region are best determined by someone who studied all of it. Not just the lake people, not just the river people, not just the desert people. So this sort of cooperation is the beginning. The government is a cooperation between the people who govern and the people who are governed. And the nature of that cooperation is part of the structure that makes a government one thing or another. And of course, how the people, who is elected, how that person is once they've been elected, does depend a lot on the civilization of the people. In answering a question, what is the role of government? There's no one simple answer. It is easy to say what government shouldn't do, although there would always be people that disagree with that too. I don't believe that people are an effect of the government. I don't believe that the government has the function of creating love in people. I don't believe that the government has the function of raising our children. And ideally, that's done with minimal interference. The interference comes when there's a dysfunctionality of people, so that that upbringing hurts the children who are by necessity dependents.
Entonces no hay una definición.
Not one, no. One standard.
Hay que hacer una por cada gobierno.
I think one needs to understand the morality behind what is that government and what the objective of that government is. You know, if you ask a congressperson in the United States what's the objective of their office, they might answer something like, to represent my constituency. But that brings the next question, how do you do it? What are the tools at the congressperson's disposal? And how do they execute their job? What is their job description? And this toolbox and the methods of being a congressperson are often not very well defined, or defined in a way that's not particularly appropriate to the interests of the people. And with modern technology, we could do so much more. As I said to you, you know, if you look at all the governments of the world, how many of them have been formulated from anew, basic principles, creating an absolutely new form of government in the past 20 years? There are not that many. But yet our technology, our ability to have global communication, our ability to have many people that can communicate very differently than they ever have, is not incorporated into older systems. I would venture to say that most systems of government are antiquated in the face of modern technology, and that a radical redirection, a reformulation of most governments, would be really helpful. But that doesn't have to be done with a revolution.
¿Cómo tiene que ser?
I believe that civic organizations can be effective forms of government without going against the government and without even utilizing the same types of enforcement that government does. Churches, for example, many different communities, but especially it's easiest to see communities represented by religions. You know, take, for example, I know a gentleman who was a bishop in the Mormon church. What's called a bishopric, which is the domain of a bishop, is a form of government. Highly organized, to the benefit of the people, in the auspices of that morality, that belief system, in this case, Mormonism. That form of government, the Mormon Church, Catholic Church, other civic organizations, the Rotary Club, operate within the normal frame of government without going against the government. If there was a civic form of government like that, that achieved the noble goals, what the old government system did, ultimately people could come to rely more on this system than on the antiquated system. And possibly even the antiquated system could either model itself more after this system, migrate over to this system, or over time just become less. That doesn't require any sort of revolution. It's more of an evolution. It's an evolution of people to understand the nature of self-governance, how they govern themselves with their own conduct, how families govern themselves, their conduct, how communities, and upward. If an individual becomes aware of the nature of their conduct and are concerned with good conduct, it then becomes the morality that determines good versus bad. That is the governing factor. If there are a group of people that can come to an agreement that a certain thing is bad, then you can have a type of government based on that morality. And it still doesn't need to involve violent enforcement. Does that help?
Sí, pero nace otra duda. Entonces, tampoco en el gobierno, o sea, ¿tú qué piensas de si las organizaciones civiles como la iglesia, como la religión, cualquiera que sea, participa en el gobierno?
Mm-hmm.
¿Tú qué piensas? ¿Debe de ser o no?
It depends how you define government. Right now, the way at least some of the government systems I'm aware of work, they propagate a more primitive way of living. In the United States, for example, politicians are often elected by people, by giving people what they want or what they think they want, as opposed to what they need.
Eso es un gobierno populista.
Yes. ¿Sí?
El que le da a la gente lo que cree que necesita en lugar de lo que necesita.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Entonces,
there's one other thing I have to say. The key is what people think they need compared to what they do need. If they are primitive, if they're just worried about comfort and pleasure, they are not thinking of the greater needs of other people they interact with. And that's the definition that I gave of civilization.
Mm-hmm.
If they are uncivilized, what they think they need is to be comfortable, satiated, and pleasured. Very hedonistic in some ways. So really the key is the population's ability to think beyond their desires and to hold an ideology that represents some sort of morality. In the communities that I mentioned, the Mormon community, the Rotary Club, those have an ideology that sometimes inconveniences the individuals. But the individuals who truly hold that ideology gladly inconvenience themselves to uphold it. Mm-hmm. So it is about the individual having that understanding, not just the morality of the body, but more noble ideals of humanity. We have to inspire that in people.
El gobierno.
No, we as the people. We as people who bring up people. We who lead in the civic organization.
Y el gobierno debe de verlos.
Government actually is an effect. And the, most of those structures were created by people who don't have that separation. Mm-hmm. And most of the elected officials are elected by people who don't have that separation. And many of those officials are the same people and don't have that separation. So a government that was created like that and inhabited people by that, like that, not only shouldn't try to create that in people, or I should say inspire that in people, but can't.
¿Y el que sí? Yo encontré uno que sí.
Well, I think there are a lot of people that can, but they have to understand that that's an important role in society. That the role of a civic leader, a community leader, is extremely important.
Y con mucha responsabilidad.
There are some communities, there's one community in Mexico, and I don't know the name of it, but they did one of the Pan American Games and had some representatives, some of the elders of this community involved in it. And it's a community that has elders. And elders make the decisions for the community. They're not paid. And they do so joyfully, because they understand the importance of it. And all the people, or many of the people in that community, understand the importance of it. We have to go back to that sort of fostering, that sort of community. And it starts in the small areas. And every community has people that have the potential to see this vision. And by people understanding this and growing in this, you can develop a government of people, so to speak, that is not a government of rules and enforcement, but is a government of ethics and, you might say, compassion.
Hay que evolucionar.
You have to get one community at a time.
Una persona a la vez.
Yes.
Y luego una familia a la vez.
Yeah.
Y luego una comunidad.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And if it comes from the government, it has an inherent problem that it is almost poison from the start. It's like it's trying to make the most wonderful cake with rancid butter. As long as the butter's in there, you have the best recipe in the world, cake won't be very good.
Entonces, las personas que conformamos el gobierno no mm-hmm. tenemos derecho a evolucionar.
People who are part of the government strip themselves of many rights to be a servant of the people. In any leadership position, the more potent the leadership position, actually the less rights the leader has. People think that if they could lead people and be potent, they would have so much more freedom and rights. But true freedom has to do with how we view our potency and how seriously we take our potency, yet maintain a sense of self. Freedom is not just wielding power however we want. Because if we think we need to do that, we don't have a strong sense of self. So the best civic leaders that you could find are people who will take their power very seriously and understand the extreme limitation of being a government employee or a leader. One of the things I suggested with you, and I don't know if you'll take this or not, and I don't know if this is the best idea or not, but in Mexico there are three main parties, and you are one of them. I suggested that you find two people of equal authority and power to yourself, two buddies, so to speak, one from each party. So there'd be your party, one of the other parties, and the third party. And the three of you do civic things all together. So there will not be any mistake that this is done in the name of one party or another, or to further some election agenda, or to further some maybe inappropriate power within government. That this is done as you, not as the mayor, not as a representative of your party, but as a Mexican, and as a human, and as a woman. And that's one way of canceling out what might be seen as improper interests.
Y dentro del gobierno no hay nada que hacer.
Well, I think there's a lot to do. I think the first thing that government needs to do, and this is something, I think, a conclusion we both came to, because you're educating me a lot about government, is that government needs to be made honorable. And that there are politicians that are honorable and others that are less honorable. And many of the politicians that are less honorable don't have the recognition or example to be honorable, that they would love to be honorable, they only understood it. So by a small group of politicians coming up with a document of principles that a person from any party will abide by, that keeps their position within government sacred and noble, and then having all the parties propagate this and adhere to it, it would make the people within the government more self-aware of their responsibility. One of the things that happens in the United States, which I don't agree with, is there'll often be two political candidates. And in the United States, we have two main parties. There are some smaller parties, but two main parties. And in order to be the person that runs for president, they have to be first the person that's elected within their party. So this doesn't only happen in the presidential election. It happens in every election almost. You'll have two or more candidates, and they will speak badly about each other. And they'll get their constituents, the people who want to vote for them, to really dislike the other candidate. So if they lose, those people will never feel good about the government, will never feel that they have a noble leader, because that leader has been tarnished. It's a type of bad media. So if all politicians could disagree with people in an honorable way, if I have a, for example, if I have an opponent that maybe I know that opponent, or I believe that opponent is a criminal. Maybe I believe that opponent does all sorts of things that I think are very bad. I could sit there and point them out. And a lot of times I'll be wrong, because an individual's judgment of another individual is very often imperfect. So what's better is that we suggest that everyone examine each of the candidates. And if I were a candidate, examining my good, my bad, thoroughly. And if we conduct ourselves honorably like that, in the least, when our opponent is elected, we won't have destroyed not only their reputation, likely with a lot of false accusations, but also destroyed each of the citizens' belief in government. It's hard to get elected if you don't smear the other candidate. But by smearing the other candidate, you destroy the sacredness of government. If you have a belief in the necessity of any government, it's better that it be an honorable government. Now, there are people who are anarchists who don't believe in government. And it's interesting, when I was a child, I was taught anarchism is bad. Until I met a professor in college who was a self-professed anarchist. And I found out that he was a very compassionate humanist. He didn't believe that government was necessary. And I don't necessarily agree with that at this point in time. In a very civilized society, government may not be necessary. But in the least, government as a representational device and a communications device is necessary now.
¿Y eso eliminaría la violencia? ¿O disminuiría la violencia?
If people were to see examples, and something I had said to you, which is just my belief, if you look at what I would call good versus bad, if you have bad intended people, they're willing to lie, cheat, and steal, and do anything to get their ends, whatever they want. For people who insist on not lying, cheating, and stealing, they're at a tremendous disadvantage. So if you and I play some game, and I'm lying and cheating and stealing, I'll probably win. But amongst humans, there's an interesting counterforce to the chaos and additional option that someone who's willing to lie, cheat, and steal has. For many of us, especially if we have empathy, when we see someone do something noble, we want to rise to be that thing. I've seen people see a movie like Gandhi, and some of them say, I wish I were in that time. I would want to be part of that struggle. They don't realize that we have struggles like that now. 50 years from now, people will say they wish they were part of this time. But all they're lacking is a Gandhi to inspire them. And the force that good has against the chaos and extra options that bad intent has, fear and hate has, is that we inspire group action.
Entonces, ¿tú crees que esta falta de civilización ha hecho que también tengamos carencia de liderazgo?
I think it's the other, it's a system. I believe that there are a lot of people who are potentially world-changing leaders who don't believe an individual can make a difference. But when you see one man, one woman stand up to injustice, everyone that witnesses it is affected. It's no longer one person standing up to injustice. It becomes many people standing up to injustice. That principle, if that became more known, and not just known in idea, but really felt from the heart, that people are willing to stand up against injustice, without even necessarily the hope of resolving the injustice. See, the important value is not to stand up to injustice needing to change the injustice, to stand up to injustice because it's the right thing to do, even if you're not going to win. People look too much at the result and they say, I can't change anything. Shouldn't matter if you can change anything. What matters is how you conduct yourself. That separation between the primitive body and our ideology. That makes sense. If you have within media, within stories, within movies, within performances, this idea represented over and over again, I think even that would have an effect. You would start having leaders in little communities standing up for injustices. The interesting thing is they may not really be injustices, but it's better to have people stand up against false injustices than to have no one stand up and be apathetic. And in that scheme that we spoke about, going from apathy to fear to anger to what I would call noble character, you move people from apathy through these things where they're willing to stand up for what they believe. Even if that belief is mistaken, it's better than being apathetic. Apathy is our biggest battle with respect to civilization and community, humanity and compassion.
Sí.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to lecture so much.
Sí. No, sé que no. No es sermón. Aprendizaje.
Well, it's interesting. For me, it's been a very hard struggle. I also believe if it's not a hard struggle, I'm not doing enough for myself, with myself, about it. If there's something that I'm apathetic about, I believe it's a fault of mine. And I work to try at least not to be apathetic. It may not be the most important issue that I address with my life force, but it's not something of apathy. I feel that apathy is the exact enemy of compassion.
Y es un trabajo duro, diario, trabajar en la apatía. Por la evolución que esto emocional representa en el ciudadano, en el ser humano.
There are practices that help with that. I think I've been fortunate in my misfortune. I've always believed that the person with the least misfortune in their life is the most misfortunate human. Mm-hmm. As a young person, I had to make decisions at times. I had a very sick mom. I lived alone with my mom. So that in moments of crisis, at times I had to make decisions that affected her health. I found myself in that position a number of times in life. Currently, I have someone that I've been very close to for almost 30 years. And she has stage 4 cancer. And there are many decisions that have to be made about her treatment. And it's come into my hands that I make some of those decisions. And with each decision, and one that I made yesterday, actually, I had to imagine if I chose option A and did not choose option B, and option A kills her, how would I feel? And then I imagine choosing option B and not choosing option A. And if I choose option B and it kills her, how would I feel? So 2 nights ago or 3 nights ago, when I made this decision, and it was actually a number of options, I killed her twice. I'm saying that lightly, but also heavily, because for me to truly weigh the decision, it depends how deeply I can accurately feel what it would be like to make that decision and have the effect of her death. And likewise, the other one. And I'll tell you, for me, in my physical body, mourning so deeply, feeling so deeply, is physically very difficult. And it's a practice that I've learned, that I've developed for me. And those sort of practices, I feel, are necessary, because when we are making decisions that are weighty decisions, we have to weight them appropriately, completely. So we have to be willing to understand how that affects other people, and as broadly as we can. And some of the courses that we offer teach people to do that, have people practice doing that, so people become deeper decision makers within their morality. You see, my understanding of her death comes from my life experience and my moral development, whatever that is. And it's different than anyone else's. So we have to learn from within our experience how to do this.
Diario.
And it turns out that there are very, very few, if any, small decisions. Because every single decision involves a principle. As an example of something that seems small, you know, and this is an example I give, what I call the infamous empty toilet paper roll. You're in a building, commercial building, completely alone, and you use the last bit of toilet paper. And you don't need any more. To replace that roll requires, you have to get up, you have to go find another roll. Takes some effort. It's so easy just to walk out of the bathroom and not replace the roll. And some people might think no one will know, but you know. And if you don't replace that role, you don't know if there are people who ever will, because you're not living the example. By replacing that role, although you know some people won't, you know that it's well within human possibility for that to be done. And you have a belief that there are other people who do that too. By replacing that toilet paper roll, for me, the world becomes a better, more optimistic place. I make all people better by being better myself. How we conduct ourselves in our decisions creates our vision of all people in the world for us. And decisions are the steering point of all behavior. So if you want to behave better, learn to make better decisions, deeper decisions, self-aware decisions, not acting on impulse or reacting. And that's the nature of character. Character is the tool we use to be able to transcend the needs of our bodies and then employ the other skills and tools of our belief systems, our morality, and our decision making to be a better person. And by witnessing ourselves as a better, more noble person, our whole world becomes full of people who are potentially better. One example in one of our intensives, and this is the last thing I'll say on this, we call this a postulate. If I were a person that never lied, I would walk around in the world and assume that no one has ever lied. I don't know what a lie is. One day, I make the discovery that I can lie and get what I want. At that point, I've consigned myself to what we call postulate hell. Before I made that discovery, when I meet you, and whatever you say, I believe you. Doesn't occur to me you would ever lie. But now that I discovered the lie, everything you say, I wonder, is she lying to me? Now I live in a world full of people who are potential liars. The road to redemption for all the liars in my world is for me to stop lying. So now I know that anyone who is a liar has the option of not lying. And by doing that, I've created redemption in my whole humanist view of people. So both condemnation and redemption of people reside in our own behavior. Ay, ay, ay.
Mucho. Pensé que yo venía por cómo resolver el problema de la fábrica de delincuentes. Mm-hmm. Número uno, que ese es para mí lo más importante. Mm-hmm. Y me mandas con mucho más trabajo. Y muchas más cosas que resolver. No nada más la de la fábrica. Mm-hmm. Y la fábrica es muy compleja, pues todas las demás.
Mm-hmm. Well, creating the tools for all people to resolve that.
Sí. Todos los tipos de personas que han convivido con la violencia, de los que hablamos ayer antier, del apático y el que vivió violencia y el que tiene familia. ¿Esos tipos?
Well, yeah, I'm talking.
¿A eso te refieres o a?
Having all people evolve to where violence is not as common, and where violence is understood through intent, so that the intent of all people can be made more positive if they're predisposed to that. and so that they deal with those that are not predisposed that way more compassionately. Compassion removes violence.
Sí, es un trabajo muy difícil.
Yeah, it's hours a day, emotional work. And that's not your day job.
Pero se puede hacer.
Mm-hmm. I agree.